right. Are we still awake? I hope so. That was a great panel. So I love coming to RSA. I love coming to San Francisco. And I've got to tell you a quick story. I travel a lot, and I'm always leaving for the airport. So I'm about to take off on Monday. I'm late. The plane was delayed. I had to get another flight. And I'm just about to get out the door, kind of early in the morning. And my son comes rushing down the stairs, my 9-year-old son. And he says, Dad, where are you going? I said, Alexander, I'm a little bit late. I've got to go to the big security conference. I've been working on this PowerPoint for a while, and it's in San Francisco. And you know, he asked me where I went, not because he really cared. He wanted to know what I was bringing him back, right? You all have kids that when you travel, it's like, what are you going to bring back? So I'm running out the door, and he says, Dad, one more thing. So what's that, Alexander? He said, could you bring me back some swag? And I said, really? You want me to bring some stuff back? He says, yeah, you know, every time you go, you always bring cool stuff back, and why don't you see what we can bring back? So I've got basically a backpack and need a Sherpa to get home at this point, so I've got plenty of stuff. But the kid is a handful. He's 9. He jailbreaks his own iPhone. I have no idea where he learned it from. But anyway, I guess he'll have some more toys to play with. So let's talk a little bit about driving security down the stack. And this is something that's near and dear to my heart. What I wanted to do, though, was I first wanted to, in the spirit of RSA, the 20-year anniversary, I wanted to basically step through my version of security over the last 20 years. And I think it's very topical, because in order to learn about security, I think you have to look to the past in order to figure out what we're going to do in the future. So let me just give you my version of this. Everybody remember this? This was a Hayes 300 baud modem. How many people had one of those, right? Yeah, there's a lot of guys out there, right? ATS 11, just try to get it to dial as fast as you could just to make sure the phone company actually took the commands. Well, I had one of these, and I actually used to dial into the McAfee bulletin board system in the late 80s, 88, 89. And I used to be so happy because I would actually get my monthly update. Imagine that, your monthly update. Right? If we even try to conceive that today, it just sounds silly. And at the time, the biggest problem that we actually had was the floppy. Right? We were just people trading floppies, and depending on what you were actually doing with that floppy, if you were trading software, things of that nature, you had a high probability of actually getting infected. And at the time, the problem that we were trying to solve was very small. Guys like John McAfee, right? Decided that they could create some software that would actually monitor for viruses, the things that the bad guys were actually doing. And the first virus was the brain virus. It was developed by two folks who decided they didn't want their software pirated, and they actually created this virus. But it was very easy to create a blacklist that would look for 50 known variants of a particular piece of malware. You know, the world has changed dramatically since that time. Not that old to remember that washing machine, but I do remember coffee pots and TVs that looked like that, and they didn't have IP addresses. Right? We think about today's world and today's connectivity, everything has an IP address, and everything is connected to the internet. So 20 years later, where are we at? World has changed dramatically. We literally see threats traverse the globe in a matter of seconds. We can see something that may start in Asia and work its way across the globe, the entire world, and we can see this happen in a matter of minutes and seconds. So the protection models for 2011 and beyond have to change, right? We can't use what we were doing for the last 20 years. And for the last 20 years, the analogy that I always like to say is it's like driving 55 in the rearview mirror. My wife's actually pretty good at that when she puts her makeup on, but I don't recommend it, right? It's not a good thing, but it's very reactive, and it means that you have to understand what threats were out there so that you can protect against them in the future. So let's talk a little bit about the old security model. This is actually a slide that I put together after I had a conversation with the CIO. And he said, George, you know what? He says, we're in an industry where I really didn't care that much about security. We're not, you know, banking, and we're not in the military. He said, but I really, really started to care last year, 2010. And I said, why is that? Why did your mindset change? And he said, well, the model that I was following was the sheep in the center of the flock. And if I was in the center of the flock, it meant that I actually had protection, right? And the only thing that I had to worry about was not being on the fringe of the herd where the sick and the weak sheep were. So that was his security model. And that's the security model that many folks have taken over the last 20 years. And with the very overused and probably perverted term at this point, APTs, you cannot certainly be secure just being in the center of the herd. Okay, so what I wanted to do is I wanted to give you some facts and figures. You know, we all know security's bad, it's tough, we have to figure out what we're gonna do to actually solve this problem. But I always like to talk at least a few numbers first to give you an idea of what the problem scope is. So these are numbers from McAfee, and you can see the increase in malware from 2007 all the way to January 2011, almost, or 56 million pieces of malware. Just a massive increase in malware. And it, just to show you how large it's been, in the last year, year and a half, we've actually created more signatures for malware than we have in the last 20 years combined. I mean, absolutely astounding. My point is, it's very, very difficult in a blacklisting world to continue to keep up with this. So let me give you some other facts and figures. 100,000 pieces of malware are processed at McAfee on a daily basis. 100,000. Every day, sun goes up, sun goes down, 100,000 pieces of malware flow through our automated systems. Okay, and of those 100,000, there are 55,000 unique pieces of malware. So what that means is that every day we have to, not just us, but this is the industry, has to create signatures and protection for 55,000 or so new pieces of malware. I mean, it's a daunting, daunting task. So the reason I go through all this is to at least try to give you an idea of the challenge that we're up against. This is another great stat. 2 million malicious websites per month are detected by our global threat intelligence teams. That's a lot of infections that take place by people simply visiting a website. Let me give you some other numbers, crimeware numbers. I love this one because I even think crimeware felt a recession, or it actually got better because the prices went down. If you look at the distributed denial of service pricing here, it used to be 100 to 200 for 24 hours. It's now about 50 bucks for the day. So they're either getting a lot more efficient at it, or you know, business is bad. I would imagine they're getting much more efficient at it. The one that I want to point out to you, though, is installation of software. I'm not sure if you've seen this, but the ecosystem is so well refined, and this is what I mean by crime is really driving the increase in malware. It's so well refined that you can actually pay to have your malware installed on any number of botnet computers. So any number of computers that have actually been commandeered, you can actually pay. And you can see the pricing here. So for 1,000 installs in the USA, it's about $110, Asia, $9. And they actually probably adjust the pricing based upon currency fluctuations, knowing these guys. I mean, they're pretty sophisticated. But if you want to actually infect these computers, you can do that. Now, the only caveat is you can't actually spam from those computers. So crime does have some rules. Can't spam from their computers because they don't want to actually get them taken down. Now, one of the biggest challenges that we have is the magnetic stripe, right? And how many... Well, I should ask the question. Do we know who the biggest offender of the MAC stripe is? What country? It's the US, right here, right? And I'll tell you a true story. I went out to, I was in traveling in Europe, running around, and I was in Italy, and I was coming back on the weekend, going to the airport, and I was driving a car, diesel car, and I went into the gas station, and I went to get gas, and you know, it's hard enough to find somebody in Italy that's there during the day. They're certainly not there on a weekend, okay? So I roll into the gas station and I put my credit card in and I don't have chip and PIN. I simply have a regular credit card. So I can't get gas and I need about 20 euros of diesel. So there's another guy that rolls in on a motorcycle and I said, oh, please, can you help me out? You know, I'll pay you $20 in cash if you can actually just put your credit card in and let me fill up. So he did that, he was nice enough, and I thanked him, and you know, I was kind of getting ready to go in the car, and he gave me one of these. And I said, well, what do you mean one of these? He goes, transaction fee. So, you know, you're gonna get you one way or another whether you use cash or not, but it really is about the money, and it really is about being able to monetize that MagStripe data and put it onto your own plastic. So if you look at credit card dumps, you can see some of the pricing here. Let me just call this out. These are actual prices for Visa and MasterCards that we've actually been tracking. And you can see the pricing, $15 for a card without a PIN, $80 with a card with a PIN, and then it kind of goes up if there's a known good balance. So my point here is there is a very well-defined economy that we have to deal with, and that really is driving this malware industry. Now, the new frontier, what is it? We all have it here. I have like the bat belt of devices, iPhones and Blackberries and iPads and everything. And it's not actually fun to travel with me in an airport because it takes so long to actually get through security. But the new frontier is mobile and embedded devices. Mobile and embedded devices. Think about this. We literally ran out of IPv4 address space last week, right, or a week or two ago, because everything is connected to the internet. And if you look at some of these devices that are out there, whether it's a medical device, whether it's an ATM, whether it's a printer, right? Printers run operating systems, embedded operating systems. How many people actually monitor their printer activity? Not many. We're starting to see people in commandeer printers and use those as launch points to attack other systems in the network. So the embedded world and the mobile world is a new frontier above and beyond just PCs. I'm not going to spend a lot of time on this because we're probably Stuxnet to death this week, but I think this actually gives you a good idea of how damaging this malware can actually be. I mean, Stuxnet is something that we're going to be studying for a long time. Targeted the power plants, targeted these fixed function embedded devices, and was very, very successful. And what I want to point out here is, and I run into a lot of folks that say, well, we've got this and we've got that, we've got an air gap. These were air gap systems. They got on there with USB devices, right? So you really have to think about your embedded devices, who's managing those, how they're securing them, and then ultimately what the bad guys can do. 10 million. It's a great number, 10 million. You will be shocked when I tell you that this is actually the average number of lines of code in a modern automobile. 10 million lines of code, okay? 70 to 80 CPUs in a modern high-end automobile, okay? One with all the bells and whistles and nav and the DVD. And if you think about the opportunity in these embedded devices, it gets really interesting. This is actually real proof of concept. CarShark. Anybody know about CAN bus hacking? CAN bus is actually the bus that allows you to jack into the car. You guys know when you go to the mechanic, what's the first thing they do? You roll in with your car, they don't even open the hood. They pop the door open and they plug the computer in and they start to do a diagnostic download. So this is the new world that we're living in, and all of these have computers, all of them need to be protected, and a lot of them have very, very low level access to the hardware that they're actually running on. So switch gears for a little bit. Let's talk about the mobile explosion, right? This is one of the areas that gets me excited because I know how great the app world is. You know, if you think about kids, if you have kids, then they have iPhones or iPads or anything. We're like old school. We would actually go to the internet and search for something. They go to the app store and they just down the app. They download the app and they run it. You know, they want to do something. It's not a search and get what you need. It's you just download the app to do that. And the mobile explosion is actually an interesting area for the bad guys. So we've seen mobile malware increase 46% since 2010. I mean, let me just paint this picture for you. You've got 300 or so thousand applications in the App Store, Apple's App Store. You've got 100 plus thousand in the Android marketplace. If I said to any one of you, why don't you go to your computer, why don't you get on the internet, not have any protection on your mobile device, and download anything you want and run it on your computer, what would you say? George, you're nuts. I'm never going to do that. But for some reason, we believe because it actually got into the App Store that somebody's looking at these. Do we really think that at the volume of 300,000 or 100,000 that people are really going through these with a fine-tooth comb? I'm not quite sure. So what I thought would be interesting was to basically give you a little demo that we put together. Everybody loves the Hacking Exposed stuff. We did one earlier today. It's kind of hard to do a big one here. But I wanted to show you a little bit of what I think is the coming wave in malware. So can we roll the video? Okay. So we've got our app store, we've got our phone. This is actually us. We've created, well, I'll show you when we go through this. So let me just walk you through. We've got the app store both in the Android world and in the Apple world. You can see these. You can see the Android world as well. And there's an application that most people have, I would bet, on their iPhone or Android device. I know I have one. And that application, as we'll see here, is, let me click through, is actually a flashlight. How many people have flashlights? I mean, I got a lot of, right? When you get a little older and you can't see well in the restaurant, you put the flashlight on. You know what I mean? So the flashlight application is one that everybody has, and it's pretty innocuous. You put it on, it turns white, and you use it. Well, we thought it would be interesting to create a flashlight application of our own that did a little bit more than just shine some light. So what I want to say before I actually start the second part of this demo is that no apps were actually harmed in the filming of this, okay? We didn't load this up in the App Store, although I have really no doubt that it would actually go through. And I will point to a flashlight application that made it through the App Store. I'm not just picking on Apple, Android is even more lax. But it got through the App Store in July of 2010. And if you remember that story, it was an app that actually had tethering. And all of a sudden, this little 99-cent application, flashlight, was like the number one app in the App Store, because it had tethering, it allowed you to basically use your iPhone as a wireless device. So I'll give you a proof point that it's not too hard to get this stuff in there. So let's take a look at, we'll move to the next slide here. Got my trusty guys in the back. Okay. So let me give you the quick and dirty scenario on this. So we've got our mobile device. This is just a little pictorial of what we're going to do here. We loaded a flashlight application, which is going to connect to Twitter. Well, not too odd to connect to Twitter, but maybe for a flashlight application. And in Twitter, it's actually going to look for a hashtag that will tell it to connect to our command and control server. So the only thing we need to do is to actually put a tiny URL and a hashtag, and it will actually go to Twitter, search that out, and it now knows where its command and control server is. So we can continue to rotate the command and pivot the command and control server. So once we do that, our flashlight registers with the command and control server, and then our command and control server actually downloads remote code. Did you know you can actually download remote code on your iPhone into the application after it's gone through the App Store? Lua code. I don't know how many folks are familiar with Lua, but Lua is a scripting, very powerful scripting language that many of the games use. If you use Angry Bird, you've run applications that have Lua in them. Well, we can simply download our own remote control botnet agent, if you will, directly into our flashlight application. So the point is, you know, we didn't put all of this remote code up into the App Store. We simply put a flashlight up there that would go out and update itself with the code that we thought was very interesting using this Lua code. Okay, so let's take a look at the video here. Okay, so now this is actually a phone that we've commandeered. You can see it. It's a Virgin Mobile Android phone. And this is a map, so based upon the GPS location of the phone, we can tell where it was, right? It's in the Mission Viejo area. And what we've done is we've actually created our own command and control server backend. And what this phone will do is it will actually check in with our backend server. So why don't we take a look at how this works? We click on the link here, and we can see that it's a Virgin Mobile phone. And then what we actually do is we actually steal the photos off the phone. So we've got a cool cat on this picture here with a little lime. I wonder where the beer bottle is. So let's take a look. We'll go a little bit further. Oh, we found the Corona. There it is. Those are what I would say black hat folks in training, right? Starting earlier. Okay, so let's take a look here. This is an Apple device, just to not pick on Android versus Apple. So we'll click on this link here. And we've got a few more pictures. You can see the device signature, which we can uniquely define each device and locate each one of them. This is a picture, I was told when we commandeered it that this is a security monkey. If you've ever been called a security monkey, I guess we found one, but I was corrected, it's actually a security ape. So at least we know what that looks like. And it must have been Valentine's Day recently, so we actually, you know, ladies, there's an available guy for you, and it's really about the thought that counts. So this is a great example of pictures that should never make it to the internet. But we've commandeered some pictures, which is, the point is, now we have access to that phone, we can suck the information out of that phone, pictures, contact information, et cetera, because we're running on that phone. So let me give you a way that we can actually monetize it. We happen to be charitable folks, and we thought that we would actually send an SMS message to the Red Cross. However, we're not going to be the ones that's donating it. Our trusty victim here actually is going to be donating this. And even if the pop-up comes up on the screen, we can actually say yes to the pop-up and continue to make the donation. So this is really the wave of the future. This took us about a week to put together. It really wasn't all that hard. And what I want to leave you with is the embedded world is an area that we really, as an industry, haven't focused on. Everybody's hopped up on mobile, but it's going to be this interaction of the mobile stores and these mobile devices where we're going to see a lot of the security issues going forward. All right, so this is just one example. Again, it was something that we put together. We didn't load it into the App Store, but you know, it's something that has been done in the past and we'll continue to see. Now, let me just give you the quick spin through on this. This is the code that we used just to show you the kind of the real deal. Although I made it in a video, we have a guy that just, Ryan Permo has helped me with this demo, did a fantastic job. So that's a little bit about mobile security. So let me talk now about advancements in security, where the rubber meets the road. I love Formula One. I'm like one of the only nuts in America, not the only one, but I stay up in the middle of the night to watch all the Formula One races, so I had to get the car shot in there. And what I want to talk about is the combination of software and hardware together and really driving security down the stack. Now, I know many of you may not be familiar with all of the acronyms, and many are. I have a hard time remembering the entire stack, and I use a little mnemonic, so I figured I would actually make this mnemonic available to you because I think it's pretty useful, which is, you know, please do not take salespeople's advice, right? So if you have any doubts on or questions on remembering the stack, you just remember that little mnemonic. But what I really want to talk about is the market trend, and it's this migration down the stack. And if we think about the threat landscape, we see threats moving from the application space, right? SAPs of the world. This one is talking about SAP rootkits and Trojans. We see issues around Windows, every flavor of Windows and Unix, we know about those. We see it moving down into the hypervisor. And if you were at our last session, we showed you how to, you know, cloud burst out of a hypervisor and gain access to the host operating system. And then ultimately, we see threats in the hardware space, right? Very, very concerning to many folks. So what we see as the future of security is that security will actually migrate from this application that runs on top of the operating system down into the hypervisor and also to be able to help activate the security. And I get this question all the time, which is, well, geez, you know, are we going to have AV in silicon? AV in silicon makes no sense. It really doesn't. I mean, why would you put blacklisting in silicon? The point of migrating down the stack is that you actually get unprecedented levels of visibility. If you can drop below the operating system and you can peer into that operating system, and the metaphor that I use is it's a cube that you can actually look into if you're sitting below the operating system, you can see that cube, you can rotate it around, you can see what's in there, and if there's malware, it's very, very easy to pick out. And it's much easier to protect against it. Think about it. If you're trying to protect at the same level, we're trying to protect the kernel, the bad guys are trying to get into the kernel, it's a race to who's going to protect the kernel. But if you drop below the operating system, you have much greater visibility into being able to protect that. And this is really a key component of driving security down the stack. Okay? The second point that I want to bring up And I was on a panel earlier in the week on blacklisting, you know, signature-based AV, things of that nature. Blacklisting versus whitelisting. As an industry, for the last 20 years, I gave you the review in history. I gave you the stats on how malware has been increasing. It is a challenge for any vendor, doesn't matter who it is, to continue to keep up with this. Now, we have all kinds of tricks and tips and, you know, cloud-based technologies to deal with it, but it's a challenge. So what I like to talk about is the industry moving from blacklisting only to more of a whitelisting model, right? And we're going to see more and more of that. Now, if you're not familiar with blacklisting and whitelisting, I give you the quick example here. When you go into the airport and you go through security, it's a blacklist model. You got a whole bunch of good people that spin through the airport. 99.9% of them are good, but everybody gets delayed, right? We get the wand. It's inconvenience. It's slow. That's sort of the blacklisting model. If you think about the whitelisting model, if you go through Heathrow, when I go there, you basically run through, you get your retinal scan, if you have one, you're on the whitelist, you're allowed through. It's a lot easier. That's the same principle in the security world. If you're on the whitelist, you can execute. If you're not on the whitelist, you can't. So let me talk about where you actually apply this, which is the biggest question I always get. Black versus white versus something in between. In the blacklist world, if you're a consumer-based or user-based application, or I should say operating system, it's very dynamic in nature, and you have a lot of software that you're loading on that system. So you want some level of blacklisting because it's dynamic. If you have systems that don't change a lot, that are very static in nature, you can whitelist that system and basically lock it down. Your servers, your point of sale systems, your common operating environments, SCADA devices. You know, if you have people surfing on your servers, you have a layer 8 problem. Not necessarily a security problem, right? You got a people problem. And you can lock these down because it's very static, and whitelisting does a great job there. And then somewhere in between is this gray list, and using reputation to figure out is the program good or bad based upon how many people are using it, what we've seen in the cloud. This is really the model that I'm talking about. Moving more to this whitelist is important. Now let me tell you how this works. And the analogy that I use here is oxygen, fire, and combustion. Everybody's really familiar with this. If you take the oxygen out of the room, you get no fire. Fire goes out. The same thing holds true in the computing world. If you have malware and you can execute that malware, you get infected. It is that simple. You need execution to take place for the infection to happen. If you can prevent the execution by turning things non-executable, by implementing whitelisting at the software and at the hardware layer, which gets really interesting where the industry is going, to be able to create this combination of trust between the hardware and the software and limit the execution, it's very, very powerful. And that's what whitelisting can deliver. So let me go through the last concept here, and this is really about isolation and compartmentalization. If you think about an oil tanker, right, if there was a breach in the hull, what happens? Well, it's compartmentalized, it's isolated. Right, you can seal off that door, just like a submarine. You know, if there's a leak, you don't want the whole ship to go down. This is the same concept that we're applying in the security world. And that is, if you have a breach in your computing infrastructure, it doesn't take the entire system down. So let me just spin you through this. This is really important because I believe this is where the industry is going. You've got your silicon layer, you've got your BIOS. How many people are concerned about their BIOS? That seems to run a lot of things once the computer boots, probably an important aspect. Hypervisors, operating system and applications. What happens when the operating system gets compromised? Well, everybody says today, well, most operating systems, you almost have to assume there's a compromise. How do you get any level of trust in your computing environment? Well, where the industry is going is creating roots of trust where you can actually operate even within the confines of an operating system that actually has been infected and compromised by malware. Because you've got secrets, you've got computing activity that's taking place in a secure, encrypted environment that you can authenticate. And the best example that I can use is if your online, if your operating system was compromised and you still wanted to actually perform an online transaction, in today's day, You know, all of your PINs and your passwords are all compromised because of keystroke logging and screen captures. By creating a root of trust where you can actually create this root in the hardware itself and extend that all the way up to the applications, you can create a much more secure computing environment and still have a transaction and a secret be protected, even if the underlying operating system has actually been compromised. So, you know, I know it may be a concept where someone says, well, geez, that's really interesting, but when are we going to deliver on that? And these things are being worked on. They're where computing has to go, because at this point, most operating systems that we're dealing with have some level of compromise, right? You almost have to assume that. And by implementing a level of trust down to the hardware level, you create this trusted computing stack. And I think this is going to be absolutely critical for the industry going forward. So let me just summarize here that I think the future's bright. You probably heard a lot of gloom and doom. I think there is a lot of security in silicon already. You don't know about it. A lot of the hardware vendors have been throwing parties that nobody's been attending. It's like, you know, hey, we have a party, nobody shows up. Because a lot of folks didn't realize how much security is in there. If you actually look at it, it's about activating the security in the silicon that we already have and leveraging a combination of software and silicon put together. So with that, I really want to thank you for your time and attention. I hope you have a fantastic RSA, and I hope to see you next year. Thank you so much.